I'm Peter Brown from Tiny & Sons Glass. Tiny & Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny & Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny & Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny & Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Everybody, and welcome to the February 6th meeting of the Pembroke Board of Selectmen, and we'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. Dan, you have an announcement to read?
I do, Mr. Chairman. The Open Space Committee was accepted by the Conway Graduate School of Landscape Design to complete Pembroke's Open Space Plan. The Open Space Committee, together with the Conway School graduate students, have compiled a survey to assist them in updating the needs of the town of Pembroke. The survey is available on the town's website and on our Facebook page. Everyone is encouraged to complete the survey. They would appreciate any and all assistance in this matter. Also, the Open Space Committee, together with the Conway School graduate students, will be making a presentation during a public forum community meeting to be held on March 2nd at 7 p.m. at the Pembroke Public Library. They are seeking input from all stakeholders in Pembroke's open space. The presentation held on January 26th was both interesting and informative, they state.
Thank you, Dan.
Whatever you did, Mike.
I have one short announcement. I would just like to update the public on the results of our textile recycling program that we have at all our schools and behind the town hall. The month of January contributed $338.25 to the Pembroke Schools PTO program. So thank you very much, folks, for continuing with textile recycling. And that's the latest update for this year.
Lou, could you say that again? I didn't hear you because my suit was too loud. Sorry.
Okay,
Sue. Dan is in excellent mood tonight because of the Patriots win.
Bill brought his hat along.
There you go.
Don't have the new one yet, but it's on the way.
We have a 7 o'clock appointment with Treasurer Collector Kathleen McCarthy. She's looking to award a bond sale. Kathleen, would you like to come up and give us a brief explanation of what you'd like?
Sure, just a quick overall. We have 19 issues that we awarded a bond to. They're made up mainly of drainage, departmental equipment, and land issues. We did a 10-year note on them. The award was going to Morgan Stanley and Company. It was at a 1.84 total interest cost. It was Apple's Bog, basically, DPW equipment, a couple of police cruises, just for an example, and the Route 14 reconstruction project drainage, all items that have been pre-approved at town meeting. I also wanted to make the town aware that we also go through, when we do a bonding issue, a credit rating. We stand in fours each time. This will be our third time in a row with the AA stable outlook. We're standing in fours, so it's very exciting for the town to maintain our credit rating.
Good job. Any questions for Kathleen from the board? Yes, Dan.
Not a question so much, but Kathleen, thank you for your stewardship of the program and keeping down to Pembroke's bond rating at a wonderful level. So you and Mike Buckley have gone, and the rest of the team have been doing a great job in that regard.
Good. That's a good point, Dan. Certainly true. Thank you. We have a motion to read if there's no other questions.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion to make Bill Boulter clerk pro tem for this evening.
Is there a second?
I second.
Thank you. Motion by Dan, second by Matthew. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Bill, I'll turn the reading of this motion over to you.
Okay, this is a vote of the Board of Selectmen. I, the clerk of the Board of Selectmen of the town of Pembroke, Massachusetts, certify that the meeting of the board held February 6, 2017, which meeting all members of the board were duly notified and in which a quorum was present. The following votes were unanimously passed, all of which appear upon the official record of the board. Voted that the sale of the $2,853,000 of the general obligation municipal purpose loan of 2017 bonds of the town dated bonds Morgan Stanley and Company, LLC, at the price of $2,998,029.44. If any, is hereby approved and confirmed. The bonds shall be payable on February 1st of this year, and in the principal amounts and their interest at the respective rates as follows. In 2018, $418,000 at the interest rate of 4%, and the year would be 2023, and the amount would be $230,000 at 3% interest rate. In 2019, it's $395,000 at 4%. 2019 is $395,004%. 2020 is $385,004%. 2021 is $385,004%. 2022 is $355,004%. 2023 is $330,003%. 2024 is $225,004%. 2025, $190,000 at 2%. 2026, $180,000 at 2.25%. And 2027, $90,000 at 2.25%. Further voted that in connection with the marketing and sales of the bonds, the preparation and distribution of the notice of sale and preliminary official statement dated January 26, 2017, and a final official statement dated February 2nd, 2017, each in such form as may be approved by the town treasurer, be and hereby ratified, confirmed, approved, and adopted. Further voted that the town treasurer and the Board of Selectmen be and hereby are authorized to execute and deliver a continuing disclosure undertaking in compliance with SEC Rule 15C2-12 in such form as may be approved by bond counsel to the town, which undertaking shall be incorporated by reference in the bonds for the benefit of the holders of the bonds from time to time. Further voted that we authorize and direct the treasurer to establish post-issuance federal tax compliance procedures in such form as the treasurer and bond council deem sufficient. Where such procedures are currently in place to review and update said procedures in order to monitor and maintain tax-exempt status of bonds. Further voted that each member of the Board of Selectmen, Town Clerk, and the Town Treasurer be and hereby are authorized to take any and all such actions and execute and deliver certificates, receipts, or other documents as may be determined by them, or any of them to be necessary or convenient to carry into effect the provisions of the foregoing votes.
Thank you, Bill. We're required to read that motion.
Further certified that the votes were taken at a meeting open to the public, no vote was taken by secret ballot, that a notice stating the place, date, and time, and agenda for the meeting, which agenda included the adoption of the vote, was filed with the clerk of the town of Pembroke, and a copy thereof posted in a manner conspicuously visible to the public at all hours in or on the municipal building where the office of the town clerk is located, or if applicable, in accordance with the alternate method of notice prescribed or approved by the Attorney General as set forth in 940 CMR 29.032B, at least 48 hours, not including Saturday, Sunday's legal holiday, prior to the time of the meeting, maintained so posted at the time of the meeting that no deliberations or discussion in connection with the sale of the bond were taken in executive session, all in accordance with the general laws, Chapter 30, Section A, 18 through 25, as amended.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Motion made and seconded. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, carried. Deemed unanimous. Next item is 99 restaurants and pubs at 166 Church Street is requesting a change of manager from Stephen Schostek to Christopher Peltier. The corporate office has submitted all the required paperwork to proceed with this transaction, and our applicant is with us. Thank you for coming in. Does the board have any questions for Mr. Peltier? Hearing none, do we have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Made by a motion by Dan, seconded by Matthew. We have no questions for the applicant. Thank you for coming in. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none. It's unanimous. We wish you the best, and I'm sure we'll see you at the restaurant.
Thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is kind of a review of a previous evening's discussion about the posting of minutes of town meetings on our website. My concern was that at the end of this past year, we were only at about a 55% compliance. We're never going to be 100%. Because agendas are always posted, and then there's a time period until the meeting occurs, and then the minutes have to be written, but they can't be posted until they're officially voted, and sometimes the particular committee does not meet on a weekly basis. So, like I say, I'm not looking for 100%, but 55% is what we're looking at. And I'm hoping that we can get enough to work higher than that. We do have a bylaw that the selectmen passed anything at this time. So I'm looking for some suggestions from the board on what we can do. And we send a letter to the chairman pointing this out to them and asking for their help and assistance. If they have a problem, they can certainly let the chair know. So does anybody have any comments?
Yes, Jeff. One comment, Mr. Chairman. I noticed that I was looking into some of those and I found out that they were posted maybe with the town clerk, but they weren't put on the town clerk. So possibly
so would the board agree that I can put together a letter to perhaps the chairman of the boards and committees, just pointing out to them what we're requiring of them as far as minutes are concerned, and we can see what kind of results we have. We're all just looking to have minutes posted so that they can be accessed by the public and by this board, because we can't attend all of the meetings, obviously. And it's a great help and a great service. We are complying with the open meeting law, which requires that they be given to the town clerk's office, but we've added another step that they can put on. So if that meets with the approval of the board, then I'll put something together.
Yes.
Right?
Absolutely.
Is that like a good idea?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
We
had the advisory board come in front of us, and they had some questions, issues, concerns that they expressed to us.
No, I don't.
And one of them was that they had requested copies of executive session minutes. And as they told us that night, they were very unhappy with the content. I was really not aware that
that's conservation.
Part of the discussion. So I regret that we never really answered them the way I wanted to answer them. So tonight, I would just like to go over that again very quickly. There's been a lot of changes made in the open meeting law enforced by the Attorney General's office regarding executive session minutes. There's been a lot of drastic changes made. And so we have been working with K&P Law, who is the town's attorneys, on these changes. And they have made available an attorney for any town that pays for their services to call them about executive session minutes or the minutes of regular meetings. And I have here in front of me a copy of a letter from KP Law that says, you have requested an opinion regarding the sufficiency of the Board of Selectmen's executive session meeting minutes for January 12th, March 23rd, and August 31st of 2015. In my opinion, the executive session meeting minutes provided to the advisory committee by the Board of Selectmen on those dates comply with the open meeting law's requirements pursuant to General Law Chapter 38, Section 22. And again, at the conclusion of this letter, which goes over those minutes, another statement, I have reviewed the minutes provided to the advisory committee. In my opinion, the substance of the executive session meeting minutes complies with the open meeting law's requirements. Specifically, the meetings provide details regarding the meeting, the members present, votes taken, and a summary of the board's decision on the topics under review. And as the board knows, our administrative assistant, Mrs. Chilcott, is responsible for going over these minutes and making sure that they get posted, and any requests that come in from anybody looking for copies of minutes, get them in the proper way that the law requires. And she does an excellent job in that regard, and this board has full confidence in her and how she handles those minutes. So we'll continue to be open here with anybody that wants to bring issues before us, and I just regret that I didn't make these statements when they were here that night. But I'm sure they'll know what I have said, and they can contact me if they have any other questions.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Can you just expound on that a little bit? I echo your sentiments about Sabrina. She does a great job, a wonderful job, a very thorough and accurate job of taking minutes. And if there are any voted on minutes that some other board or committee or the public meeting seems deemed deficient in their view, it's on the Board of Selectmen, it's us. We're the ones that review and approve the minutes as an accurate representation of the meetings that were held. As you mentioned also, state law dictates what can and cannot be in executive session minutes. So I think Sabrina has done a wonderful job in conveying the votes and what went on in those meetings, but also not putting information out there that that does not need to be under state law. So if there's any issues with any minutes, public or executive session, it's on the Board of Selectmen and directed questions to us and toward us.
Thank you, Jeff. Any other comments from the board members? So thank you very much, and we'll move on to the next item on the agenda, which is a request by Mike Dionne, the race director of the Ragnar Relay Series, to use the town's roads during the course of a 200-mile Cape Cod relay from Nantasket Beach to Provincetown. Police Chief Wall is reviewing this request now, and we need to hear from him to make any vote that we take 100% valid. They're going to be using the town of Pembroke for only part of this race, and they are willing to pay for, and the police chief will provide a police officer at crossroads of any street that they run on. The date and time that the runners will begin entering Pembroke is Friday, May 12th from 7:30 a.m. and could continue throughout the day until 6:30 p.m.
I'm ready to make a motion on that. If you receive a motion.
Yes, thank you.
I would like to grant, these people have done this every year for the last several years, and I've actually worked with them myself when I was working on the town police department. So I'd like to make a motion to grant the use of the town road for the Cape Cod Relay Road Race. Held by Rigor Events of Old Oak Street, Union Street, and Church Street on Friday, May 12th from 7:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. Conditionally upon the approval of the Chief of Police.
A motion by Bill, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Matthew. Any questions from the board on this motion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. I deem it unanimous. The next item we have on our agenda is to set a date and the minimum bid for a surplus property auction street, assessors parcel B2-3115. We have information on how the town would go about having this surplus property auction. It's owned by the town. It's a parcel on Barber Street. We're looking estimating advertising cost of $55, legal cost $550, and the assessed value of this parcel is $600. So based on those numbers, we are suggesting a minimum bid on the parcel to cover associated costs of the auction plus the asset value of the land to be $1,200. The earliest the advertising can appear in the Pembroke Mariner Express is February 17, 2017. We have questions from the board or a motion on this?
I have a question first. I understand, I remember the abutters coming before us, and I understand their interest in this land, and we as a board promised to move forward on this auction as soon as possible for the convenience of all involved. But Ed, we were going to look at a couple of other parcels to do a few at once, and I don't see any here, so I just want to see, and I don't have an issue with that, right. I just want to see what your assessment was.
What happened is that some of those parcels are under care and custody of the treasurer collector, and that would necessitate a town meeting vote. And of course, she has plans for some of the properties that are of considerable value that we've auctioned off with a professional auctioneer in the past. So right now, we didn't have anything else that we thought would be of consequence for the selectmen to act on right now. So this would be the only parcel. I might add that Selectman Boyle did mention in his email to me, and he's running a little bit late today, that he has suggested to the board that the minimum asking price be $5,000. Certainly up to the board to make that decision, but as Sabrina mentioned in her memorandum to you, the earliest we would advertise would be February 17th. And probably we won't have to go into the central register, but I would suggest the first Monday of March as being the date for the auction.
Does that have to be decided upon tonight, or can we put this off until the show's up? He does plan on being here.
Yeah, he's planning on being here in about a half an hour.
So you could postpone the action on this, so on this item?
Right. He's got some interest in it.
Okay. Acceptable to the board?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Next item on our agenda is to vote to accept the minutes of January 30th, 2017.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to accept the minutes of January 30th.
Yes, thank you. Second. Second by Matthew, motion by Dan. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of the passing of the minutes, please say aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous. Under old business, we have an issue regarding the animal control officer, but we're going to postpone that item, Mr. Thorne, for a week.
We had actually, I had a meeting with the animal control officer today, and I thought that he was planning on being there to explain what he wanted, so I think we'll wait until he shows up.
Okay, that's fine. So we will put a hold on that a little later, and the next item we're going to discuss will be River Marsh LLC's application for site eligibility, Mass General Law C-40B at 274 Water Street. We had a public hearing on this last week, and we were very well attended, and we heard a lot of issues from the folks who live in that area who will be direct abutters to that property. And people that have lived on that street for a long time. Do we have any issues from the board that you'd like to mention? Bill?
Yeah, I would. I'm the representative of North River Commission. I talked to the secretary last Thursday, because we had a meeting last Thursday night. And I talked to the secretary about if she had received or had any contact at all with the applicant, and if they filed any plans or anything, any type of meeting with the North River Commission. They have not up to date from last Thursday night. And she had said that she would contact me if they did come forward with any plans or requested a meeting with the North River Commission. I did type up a letter. Do you still have that letter from just a couple of things in here? I did type up a letter of concern to go to the Mass Housing. And if I could be just briefly my letter of concern, it just brings out some very important points that I think. In the first part of the letter, I indicated what my involvement with the town of Pembroke has been over the last number of 40-something plus years. Being on the commission, being on the fisheries commission, being on the Pembroke Watershed and North River Watershed Association, Central Plymouth County Water District Commission, the other boards and commissions that I've served on in the town. So I wanted to explain to them what my feelings were as Selectmen, and indicated that for the years that I've spent here on the town, that I'm looking for the best interests of what could take place in Pembroke. So on Monday, the Selectmen held a public meeting about this 40 project off of Water Street in Riverlands Village. And I heard resident after resident testimony about why and how that would affect, it would be affected by his decision to allow such a project. From land valuations dropping to the value of their homes to traffic concerns both on Water Street and Cross Street, entering on 139, by another concerns to gain the species. Water and sewage concerns, the North River Protection Act, I plan on putting a copy of that act with the letter to the wind. But the act was put in place for the purpose of promoting public safety, health and welfare, and protecting public and private property, wildlife, freshwater fisheries, and irreplaceable wild and recreational resources. So one of the biggest concerns is land being registered as wetlands. The owner of paying taxes reduced rates for a number of years. People have purchased their property under the knowledge of the protected area and because of the wetlands. I attended a scheduled walkthrough on the property on January 25th, but was denied because the owner saw more people there than he expected to show up. The tide was very high at the time, and it was several days of rain before the walkthrough, and I don't know if this had anything to do with the refusal or the cancellation, but it just appears that way. During my time as a police officer, I responded to a number of very bad accidents, with some being fatal and other being very serious injuries. Route 139 Water Street, intersecting ways is a very fast road, and concerns me that there may even be more traffic and people injured in that area. Cannot comment on the River Protection Act as I have not been given any plans to go by to make a decision. I was given copies of three maps marked C1, C2, and EX1 to observe and found them to be outdated from 2002. Information provided 14 years ago, EX1 was denied because of the flagging of the wetland. So if it was wrong then the new maps proposed C1 and C2, which were different, and I thought that they were the same when I first looked at them, but I found after examining them, they were both different. Would also be wrong. It's hard to make a proper decision on wrong information. And I understand that there's no thought process about doing a new flagging or having the wetlands posted properly before the new plans are made. That they're going to file the old plans and see if it gets approved under the old plan. It just doesn't appear to me if the wetlands were flagged in proper the first time and these plans were made on improper flagged lands. That doesn't make sense to me either. Tony just said that I'm sure they can receive and read everybody's concerns from the public hearing because it was recorded. And that will be forwarded to them. Town of Pembroke has been a good partner with 40B proposals and building units throughout the town to stay within the law. This project of 68 units on the site to obtain 6 or 7 affordable units is not the best interest of the residents of the town of Pembroke. Closing the public hearing, the Board of Selectmen voted a moratorium on 40B proposals for 1 year to give the Board of Assessors the time to evaluate the town's position in the state. And thank you for your anticipated assistance.
Thank you, Bill. Any other comments from the board? Statements?
I just want to expand a little bit on Bill's comments about the wetlands delineation being misrepresented in the plan and how that plan is being put forth as for site plan approval. That's 2002 plan. It doesn't even take into account the new FEMA flood maps. So they're proposing a project on woefully outdated maps to maximize the density and an obvious plan to put a behemoth on a site and then hoping we'll be in the middle at some point. I think it's clear from the public outcry and from this Board of Selectmen's outcry that we have no intention of meeting in the middle. We have every intention on fighting this project to the greatest extent of the law.
I think Bill said it wrong. Thank you for your research on that.
We have with us this evening the Board of Health agent, Conservation agent, excuse me, Bob, Mr. Bob Clark. Bob, you come up front and I'd like to get in for this board and for the people present your observations on this whole project.
As Bill said, my observation recently was from the street or 60 feet down the driveway. It was as far as we were allowed to go at the site visit. You don't see much there other than it appears to be very wet from that observation point, and that's the high spot. We have a file that you've been hearing that the O2 wetland line area was established of that piece of property back then after a number of walks. It was renewed once. It's way out of date. It has actually no value for any report right now. I mean, it is a dead item other than something that's interesting to see what happened. At the time it was done under some of the older wetlands ways. In other words, it was done strictly vegetation and observation, no soils. It was checked by members of the Conservation Commission, not by a professional. So it was, I don't want to say they didn't know what they were doing. They were not experts at checking what was there. It was accepted after a number of times, but it could change and it could be very wrong because soils in that area, I think, are going to show that the wetlands are much higher than where they were flagged for in the observations. We had all that filing from 02 and 03, but it really doesn't show us anything that's going on there now other than it never gets better with the wetlands. I mean, you're not getting more upland. If anything, you're going to be getting more of a wetland area. You take the wetland lines that are shown on these maps, give yourself even 50 feet off of them, which is a bare minimum for any work to be done. You're going to be hard pressed to try to put in anywhere near that number of houses. You have a wetland crossing because part of this upland area is not physically connected to the rest of it. So it means that they're going to have to do a wetlands crossing of some sort. Major problems. And it all is a very low area. I think the highest area is 20 some feet above the sea level, and it drops down to into the water at 6. It just seems very hard to believe that they're going to try to put anywhere near this tiny units in there, in a sewage system.
I think the tides have noticeably been rising over the years also. So what was in 2002 for a tide, they're doing research up in Boston now about what the tide of water is going to be in the future.
Joking about it, you may have to put a no wake zone out on the road.
Bob, could you just explain when there's a wetlands crossing, would there be a replication required as well?
Yes.
Could you explain to the public who may not be fully aware of what happens in that case?
Whenever you destroy a piece of wetland, or use a piece of wetland that's there naturally, and fill it in, or work it, and make it something other than wetland, you have to replicate at least even. In this town, we say 2.5 times the square foot for every foot that's done. And that means they're going to take some of the upland and make some of the upland back into wetland again. So again, you're losing that much more. And it's a process that's, you replicate, but you never replicate correctly. I mean, right, you don't come up with a good replication area. Very seldom you come up with a good replication area after doing something like this. And the little bit I've seen of plans, we don't have any new plans to work with. It appears that the wetlands crossing also is going to have to take the sewage lines through it, which is, if that's the case, is another possible big problem with running the sewage lines through a piece of wetland back up to the other side. It was my understanding that the sewage plant was to be out on what we call the island.
Thank you.
All the old maps are here. Anyone?
Mr. Chairman, while you have conservation agent here, does the public have any questions right here specifically?
Yeah, I'll recognize someone. This lady on the back.
I'm Shannon Wilson. I'm at 248 Water Street, which is the old house in the beginning of Water Street. So the very first house, right? 139, my house. The way that Murphy has proposed it will make a horseshoe around my entire house. He plans to go in, paving over my driveway for no apparent reason, and go in. Within 2 feet of our rear property line is an old trench that he's done for perk tests that fills every time it rains and holds water. So So I would like to be extraordinarily clear that whatever our old version of wetlands were has now come up all the way to my property lines. Every spring without fail the flora that comes through is wetlands. There's no question about it. It has come all the way forwards. So he doesn't even have a smidgen of what he believes to be his future Brigantine Circle. He does not have any of that. It is not possible through regular observation over 20 years. It has moved this far forwards.
Even the narrative in these show that there were numerous test pits dug throughout the whole area, and almost all of them show holding of water a good part of the time.
But I totally agree with you, and I'm saying that the immediate entrance to what he proposes is waterlogged. It is unbuildable. It is non-perkable. Whatever he has written thus far, no longer in any way, shape, or form, through observation over 20 years, doesn't work. It is everything he has written is now completely false, were it true at the time.
Maybe I could explain to them how we would be doing this at the present time. They would hire a professional to go out and do what they thought was a wetland line. They have it surveyed, placed on a plan, and bring it before conservation. Then the law now allows us to hire a professional at their expense to go out and check what was done. And if they don't agree, then the two of them usually will get together till we come up with an agreement, and then conservation would accept that line.
May I ask a question? So I understand that process. And is that still required on 40Bs, or is there an exception to that?
It's still on 40Bs. Conservation is one of the few boards that still has some power yes, it has to be done.
I'm sorry for re-asking a question, but will conservation be writing to the state? We understand that there is something coming down February 8th from the state, so we feel most of us here are from Water Street, and we feel very much under the gun about this. Would conservation be willing to write a letter to this effect to the state on our behalf?
I believe through the selectmen, we will have all of our comments done that way, but we really have nothing to go on, because all we have is an 0203 set of plans and a quick look on the hood of somebody's truck the other day of what the new plans are. So. We're going by old information.
I think there was an extension reached with Sabrina. Do you have the new date for the extension or the filing of the thing?
Yeah, but we're still holding the need to keep everybody on task and make sure that that report is perfect. And we're waiting for the North River Commission. We're waiting for North and South River Watershed Association. Yeah. That extra 5 business days builds in bringing exterior consultants and professionals in to give their input. But the departments we were trying to keep on task in January.
Yes, well, the town will be forwarding documentation with specific concerns from many departments, and that will include the Board of Selectmen as well, and Mr. Clerk as well. And we have a lot of questions about this project, and here is the champion coming right now. We were just kind of finishing up on a discussion about the Water Street Pond project, and we have talked about what you guys proposed at our last meeting. So if you feel that you're ready to dig in on that, we'll turn it over to you.
I'm always ready. We proposed unanimously a moratorium on the project for multi-unit buildings. That would be townhouses specifically, you know, a lot of families. So I think based on the fact that it's an environmentally sensitive area, we've got, you know, the potential for, endangered species, but we've got a whole lot of issues that I think we need to talk about fertilizer and all the things that you do to treat lawns, and you have oil and gasoline running off of roads. They run into the North River, and Bill, you can speak to it probably better than I can, as a member of the North River Commission. I think we're on good ground. I don't know that it's solid ground yet, but we need to work with the wildlife people and the North River Commission and the North-South River Watershed Association and put an effort together to basically stop what is a terrible plan. I don't know how much more than that at this point.
Another step that we're planning on taking is to discuss with the planning board to hold public hearings for a proposed zoning bylaw amendment and to submit that amendment as an article at the annual town meeting in May. So that's another issue that this board and the town offices are going to be working on. So if there are no other questions, anyone else have a question? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is George Howe. I live on 285 Water Street. Thank you for your support, by the way. This has just sort of hit us as a neighborhood. We've been doing a lot of research on our own, and it seems like, you know, most of the 40B projects that are out there on the South Shore ultimately get approved to some point. To Mr. Trabucco's point, you know, it's clear that he's probably overshot, what he's trying to build, right? So 70 units, but he really is fine with half of that, right? That's kind of the plan, it seems like. In most of the 40Bs, the cases that I've just researched, it does seem like inevitably they get built, because this 40B law is just a way to usurp a lot of the good work that, you know, the towns do, whether it's conservation commissions, zoning boards, or what have you. Is there anything else that is unique about that piece of property, other than wetlands and abutting the North River, that, you know, we can highlight and fight, quite frankly? Because, like I said, as a neighborhood, there's a few of us here that are represented. You saw many of us the other night. This is, I don't think I have to tell you, this is very impactful. These are real lives, and real people that will be impacted by this. And I know we as a neighborhood are planning to fight this just as much as we possibly can by any means necessary. Again, that's why I thank you for all your support, but we just need to know. It's kind of like we need to know what we don't know, right? I mean, what else is there about that property that we can point out and just stop building completely forever?
Yeah. So, Chapter 40B, it's an insidious law. And the state of Massachusetts had a chance via a referendum to stop it, or at least neuter it, and it was voted back in. It was voted back in without any changes. So not only is it a law that was foisted upon us, but it's also backed up by a vote, a referendum from the Fort Commonwealth. And I'll tell you what, that might have been the popular vote, but if each town had its way, Pembroke would not have voted that in. But it's a law of the land, and they have a way of usurping so much local control, so much local zoning, and when they have that fine line of 10% housing stock, you're either 10% or you're not. And Pembroke is not. It's just under.
But isn't that a perpetual number? That's like a rolling number, right? You can't, it's never going to get to 10%.
That's what makes the Warren city. It's right. That, and also, in my opinion, that it's not for the cause that it proposes, that it's for housing. For low-income housing, what it is, it's a boon for the developers.
Right.
Holy cow! It really is. And Pembroke has been doing what we can in that regard. And we had the large 40B that was thrown upon us and went through up on Oak Street, and then we've had a couple of smaller ones that came in and we didn't fight them tooth and nail because they were not great projects for Pembroke, but they weren't terrible and outrageous. There's one on Bird Street, for instance, that's in the works right now. Not the best project for the town, but you have to pick your battles. This Water Street project is a battle we're picking because it's the wrong project in the wrong spot in town. And one of the things that we can do is that you can sink your teeth into is safety. The roadways, as you all know as residents, are unsafe for a large development there. So that's one of the things that we will look at and that we can fight with. You can't fight with the overall concept of it doesn't fit in our town. It's not what we want as citizens because we don't have that right. The law is the law, but you can't fight on safety. So that's one of the things that we're looking to very, very closely.
Thank you, Dan. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Marty, 260 Water Street. I spoke last Monday as well. Is there any update on that 1.5% open land? I can't remember the details of it.
Yeah, we're looking into that. Ed, is there any update?
It'll be part of the report.
And I'll tell you, the last project, the Bird Street project, that did go through that. As they say, we didn't fight tooth and nail against, but we did have a list of complaints and cautions, hoping that the project wouldn't go through. That 1.5% we did put in, but I think we missed it on
a time. Yeah, it was a time frame issue.
We had a timeline issue with that because credit to Kathy Salmon, our chief assessor, for coming up with that. But we didn't get the data in time. I promise you, this time we will.
The issues of safety, will there be comments from the chief of police and the fireman?
Yes, certainly. Yeah, most definitely. They plan on making.
And I know I highlighted like there's two entrance ways within 700 feet of that hairpin turn at 139. The curvature where there's a number of small children that play in the front yards goes right into that 50-foot entrance way. I know you guys are all aware of kind of just in case, there are some very dangerous situations that are not necessarily visible to the maps that they are presenting.
The maps are inaccurate. That's the bottom line, is that do we have anything to say about the fact that the maps are inaccurate that they've submitted? They're erroneous.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sabrina just pointed out to me an ally that we haven't had in previous 40 years, and that's the Department of Energy and Environmental Affairs and Maintenance Species Department, where we were made aware of certain species that may be on that property that we will investigate them and open comments from the United States as well.
Just as an add-on on that, several years ago, we were working with Habitat for Humanity to build a house on an acre of land in Pembroke. And it was an excellent lot, it perked, everything was great. But they found spotted turtles on the land, and the people close by were not too happy about a house going in there, I guess. And they really pushed it, and we had to abandon that property. So if there are endangered species on that property, I would assume that's gonna go a long way
and there are.
I had a question. I understand from viewing the material that we might all seen that this project was previously attempted in 2005 on the exact same lot by the developer's father. Does anyone on the board know why that petition was denied?
It was proposed as a subdivision, not as a 40B.
We've done both.
It was
I wrote a letter to the paper, and Mr. Murphy called me up to discuss the letter, and it was a 40B.
Yep.
How far it got, I have no idea. I thought it was shut down by the state. It was for about 240 apartments or something. Or
I think
something
that's where I had heard that it was flagged improperly, and when they went out there and investigated where the wetlands were flagged and all that, it was done improper. So it wasn't right. So that's what I heard, that why it was denied. That's why I think it's so important that a new survey is completely done there. Because that may bring the wetlands up a lot closer. And then, if they stay where they are now, the commission only has jurisdiction within that 300 feet. So if that changes, that could change a lot of things. So the commission may have some more teeth into it. Is that what they've done? Benefit us.
So the one thing to keep in mind is that the previous thought of 40B, if it's not an application that's before the Board of Selectmen, then it's not an actual application. So the last time in 2002, it was a proposal for a subdivision. Well, because of frontages and access, the previous owner, Mr. Murphy Sr., if that's the right term, couldn't get a subdivision in without zoning board variances and planning board variances. So the hammer of, I'll make it a 40B unless you give me this, was used. So, but it was never officially an application. So it was just a ploy to try to get a subdivision in.
We got letters on that one as abutters from Murphy. So you guys may not have seen it, but we got letters that he was going to put in, I think it was only 16, but it was apartment buildings. We did get, I'm sorry, this is our third round at the rodeo on this one for abutters. I don't know how far it went from you guys. Sorry?
We had that knowledge, it may help us to take a look at that.
Like, I don't know that I have the letter anymore, but I certainly clearly remember. I don't know if you all remember it, but.
So, a history on that property from the zoning department, because I just want to make sure that I'm not giving false information.
But this is definitely, without a doubt, my third time at the bat on this.
My information, the reason I asked the question is because somebody in our group found an article in the Enterprise from 2005 that said it was a project.
Yeah.
On
so
that
you got shot down
right.
And had permission to your name.
And I have it on my phone.
Exactly.
Yep.
I emailed it to you.
And
I don't know if it's accurate.
Yep. And Libby Bates came in as an assessor of the time and said, how did this happen? Did you wave a magic wand because this was unbuildable and you haven't paid taxes? And you admitted it was unbuildable. That was 2005.
Didn't the Lenahan still own it then?
Lenahan's is not in question because that's on Water Street proper. We're talking behind Lenahan's is the new access, the little piece.
Right, that must be the disconnect of what.
Okay, so Lenahan's is not on the table at all. The access has always been between 248 and 300 Water Street. Lenahan's still lived there, and that was his main access. And there wasn't turning radius from jump. All the wetlands were always on the table. All the problems were always on the table. There was never turning radius, et cetera, et cetera. And so he hasn't paid taxes on it because he knew it was wetlands the whole time.
Okay. Any other questions? This lady, yes, ma'am?
Jen Johnson, 12 Cross Street. I'm just wondering if, I think as George said earlier, then like the 68 unit, you know, would end up getting sort of compromised down to say 30 units or whatever you might say. Then at that point, it's not helping Pembroke much to reach that 10%. Does that give Pembroke a little power in saying, like, well, that help is now going to add,
well, there is, if I may, Mr. Chairman, so under Chapter 40B, the developer has a tremendous leeway in scope. But the town also can, time is money, and lawyers cost money, so the more we fight, the more they have to pay, and the more they get delayed. So developers, even in ones that they can come in and hit a town over the head with a hammer, they still are willing to negotiate to some extent to stay out of court. So we'll see where this goes, and we'll certainly, if it's thrust upon us and we have no choice, through the state, we'll still try to negotiate the best deal for the town.
Have we thought about buying it as a town? Is there anything we can do to aid that?
We have not to this point.
Can we put it on the table?
Put it on the table, but he doesn't have to sell it to us because there's no purchase and sale agreement for us to basically step into the buyer's shoes But you said you sent me an email?
Yes, sir. Sorry, I was. I sent an email, it was on the 3rd, to Casey Driscoll, who was collecting the letters. And it had two articles from the Brockton Enterprise in reference to the 40B project that the Delphic Associates LLC of New Bedford. Seeking to develop townhouses, 17 buildings on a 20-acre parcel on Water Street extension to be called North River Village. The townhouses proposed for the land owned by an old developer, William Murphy Jr., at the price of $399,560,000. There's more to the article, but I sent two articles over that, to jog your memory, and I actually requested minutes. The minutes exist from back then. That we can look at?
There would be minutes to look at, and I'll make sure I call Casey tomorrow because I didn't get them.
Casey's compiling all of the public response. Okay. That's one of the many appendices, so she's compiling them. Okay. She wouldn't necessarily have covered them, she wouldn't have instructed them. So we'll get it out for you.
Well, we're on this, folks, and our next job and really important one is to get our responses written and make sure we include everybody and get those into Boston. And I'm sure that'll go a long way to give the housing folks in Boston an idea of where we see this project. And we don't want it. So hopefully that's gonna have a big impact. So.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to drag us on, but do you have any idea what the time frame is? Because a lot of us have discussed certain things that we can do as private citizens, hire attorneys, hire consultants, different types of things, and I'm just trying to get an idea on where we are. It's still a little bit confusing where we are in the whole stage of this.
Well, we have a target date that we have to meet. And we must meet that date. So that's our first and most important task to do. So this board and town administrator will stay on top of that and get that going.
But from your experience, how long does it take generally the state to respond? I mean, are we 6 months before we hear, or 6 weeks, or are we...
Well, I don't know the answer to that myself. Can I ask you? Do you have any insight on that?
It could be 30 days.
I think it was 6 weeks for Poplarwood, but we can't predict what Mass Housing's workload looks like. I mean, you can only put them into the standard set of time frames that you expect from them. And it's 30 days to 6 weeks. general.
Oh, we're working with a specific person. And once we get the responses in there, we can stay on top of that person and maybe get those answers. Where are they? Have you got 10 other towns ahead of us or what?
So I don't think it would hurt to get a hold of your legislators and representatives or stuff like that also.
So just so everyone knows where we are right now, what's before us that we spoke about the other night is a site plan approval application. And I'm sure you folks know what you're so into it, but just folks at home who might not know. So there's a site plan approval application in for us now, and that goes to Mass Housing, and Mass Housing makes determination of site approval. And then from the next stage is the developer may or may not apply for a comprehensive permit. Once they apply for a comprehensive permit, now those meetings are held in the Zoning Board of Appeals. And those can go on for weeks, and sometimes they go on for a year.
Would those require updated maps, flagging, wetland conservation, for him to go to a comprehensive meeting? Would it require him to have less vague information?
Absolutely.
Do we get notice?
Yep.
The butters get notices. One of the things, though, and so you know, and if these meetings do drag on, and some tend to, especially contentious ones that are being fought by a town, the initial notice is put out to all the butters, but then the subsequent meetings, when they get pushed off, and the next meeting, I don't believe you don't get notice to every single meeting. So the folks that are interested really need to stay interested and stay in touch so that you don't get shut out.
Posted through town of Pembroke?
The meeting agendas are posted through the town of
Pembroke. Postponements as well?
Postponements as well, okay. Sure.
Dan, what we may want to do is establish an email, a broadcast email list, so that you can alert them to any scheduled meeting that's going on in case, finally, the developer strategy is to wear out the neighbors, and they'll confuse you with dates, and they'll cancel meetings and stuff. So, if they have a broadcast email, it would be a simple way of getting in touch.
I have a question. At what point, when they apply for the comprehensive permit, they go to Zoning Board of Appeals, and you deny them their permit? Are they still allowed to build the project?
We can't deny a permit. We can only reject it on our end, but it's up to Mass Housing to
lay a full purview on the whole thing.
They do at the end. The Zoning Board of Appeals, and you'll hear more of this from them who are fine-tuned on the subject, we'll say. So they take the hearings on it, and they have recommendations for the project. But even if they deny the project, it still goes to Mass Housing for their review, who are the ultimate jurors on this, Mass Housing.
So all these government agencies that say it's environmentally protected and everything, they can still bypass all that and still get a permit?
I would say all of them, especially environmental ones.
Which one should we work on the most? Because there's a lot involved. I mean, there's a lot of different agencies come across our view, and it seems like they all have, I've dealt with the North River Commission before to put in a dock at my property, and I had to deal with the Army Corps of Engineers and everything else, but the North River Commission seemed to be the most powerful agency around. It seems like now that they don't have much power over this.
Well, they do as long as it's within their jurisdiction. That's why it's so important to delineate exactly where the wetland is, where that mark is, so, the 300 foot back and all that. So all that falls within the jurisdiction. So if it goes beyond that, then unfortunately they don't have that jurisdiction.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I just wanted, I'm Patrick from Representative Cutler's office. I just wanted to say that, you know, we're listening to the board and all of you, and we'll also be drafting a letter to Mass Housing in opposition to the project.
We may want to send a letter, Patrick, to DEP as well.
DEP?
Yeah, because we have a concern for the runoff for the fertilizers and the gas and oil and that kind of thing.
And thermal pollution, which hasn't been brought up this entire time. And that's a major concern for the North River. The deforestation is clearly evident. You see it, thermal pollution mostly used in nuclear power sites, but it's not. That's just one of the most visible signs. It's deforestation has a direct impact on floodplains, and then the algae blooms, pollution, and decimating species of both flora and fauna within the North River and all the organisms that stand within an established habitat by changing the temperature of the water.
Yeah, I know there's been some discussion also about some other rivers have a 500 foot setback rather than a creek. And also, there's been some discussion about maybe also fish being a legislation to change that.
Well, it's good to know we have the legislature right here tonight. So we're off to a good start.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pat.
So, yeah. Thank you.
Okay. So thank you all for coming. And we're working on your behalf. And we're available if you need to know what's going on.
May I just ask what cooking for the Red State 275? Where would you find the letter that you guys ultimately composed? Where would you vote to put it on the website? On the website, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Thanks again for coming out tonight.
Thank you very much.
If you could have a team gather or two to gather up emails.
Raise your hand. Thank you.
Oh, really?
Oh, So there will be one more building in Pembroke for 1 year. Or more than that. I'm excited.
Good. You're
going
to do it?
Okay.
Hi, I'm Devin. He's going to. Sabrina. No problem. She's going to send him. He's going to send her an email and then she's going to be broadcasting. It was broadcast to set up a test.
Okay, I'd like to go back a little bit to an item that we talked about, and that was the surplus property lot for Barton Street. And I'm going to do identified as costs for us to have the auction. And it adds up to $1,200. And we stated earlier that we have here in Marina, where we
2017, and Selectmen Boyle has commented he'd like to make as far as the asking price for this property. What that dollar amount would be as a minimum bid. Anyone have any comments on that? Any ideas on what you'd like to see as a minimum bid for that property?
Can we do anything that's like set a minimum bid that's subject to the fact that if our costs run higher, we're going to get that additional fee we tacked on at the end?
I think you can do that, but I mean, you know, this $1,250 in hard cost, there's soft cost, and they're probably equal to that. I think you're talking about $2,500 to $3,000 to make it right. You know, the other thing is you have to be in a position to, you know, be able to use it, because if the abutter bids $3,000 and one of his neighbors bids $4,000 despite him, I mean, now you've got, you know, a mess on your hands.
Any other ideas from anybody they'd like to mention on a minimum price?
You won't like my minimum price.
You want to come up front, sir? I know this is all about you.
Sure. So you're saying the town cost is $1,250, that's for advertising and fees to transfer titles and things like that. So at 50%, you know, markup, you're at $2,600. To me, I think that's more than reasonable for starting that. It's pretty much landlocked. I own all around it. And I know by law, you guys just can't sell it to me directly. But, you know, if somebody outbids me, they're stuck with a piece of property they can't do anything with. You can't build on it. I own all around it. You have no access to it. Can you just sell it to me? Direct?
No.
I'll write you a check right now.
Any questions? I'm sorry.
Well, Dean Kubicki. I'm 30 bar. I own 30 bar.
Yes,
street.
Right. I remember.
I own all the parcels around that little parcel. And the other thing too, I think you guys should take into consideration is you've owned the property for 32 years. So, I mean, for 32 years, it really hasn't been an issue. And then, of course, I buy the house 2 years ago and try to build a garage, and
when, in May, I found out, oh, you don't own that little piece. You're not within your setback. So, I mean, all of my neighbors were already notified. All the abutters were notified. I was the only one that showed up at the first meeting. So I'm friendly with all my neighbors, but I would think $2,500 to me is a reasonable price to pay for that. And I'm praying that I'm the only one that's going to give up $2,500 because the piece of property only benefits me. Nobody else can do anything with it.
What would the attorney's fees and filing fees and all that be?
It's all there.
It's all there.
Yeah.
$1,200 total.
And on the other end, you guys are going to be making money off of me for the or whoever else if I ever sell. You know, it's going to increase the tax rate. It's going to increase, like I said before, if I build the garage, which I plan to do, it's going to increase the property value. It'll jack up the property values of the neighborhood. You know, some of my neighbors are really happy. They're hoping I build a garage. You
know, the rising tax raises all boats.
Pretty much.
Which I'm in a bit 25.
Yeah, I would think 25 is, you know, that's 50%, Mark. That's pretty good. You know,
I make a motion that we go with $2,500.
Second. Motion by Bill and second by Arthur. Any questions or comments?
I hope he doesn't have any enemies in the neighborhood now.
Well, you're right, it would be a battle. And I'm a nice guy, too, so.
So we have a motion and a second, and no further questions. All those in favor of setting a minimum bid of $2,500, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, it's unanimous.
Thanks, guys. What do you think, like,
sometime in March? Probably Monday or March.
You'll put the notice with the one. And now is it done? It's a sealed bid?
Yeah.
So do we like write a check and put it in an envelope?
It's always been certified funds in that amount
certified
for
funds.
The bid.
Okay.
Yeah. Which fine. Discourages anybody who's really not interested.
Right. And who do we deliver that to? You? Okay.
It'll be in the advertisement. The advertisement will be on the Sunday.
And the Mariner Express. All right. Great. Thanks, guys. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Town administrator's
report. I got Mr. Martin here to address an issue regarding the truck.
Joe, just by
hi. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good to see you, Bill.
This is pertaining to Mr. Lally at 215 Pelham. They had come to my attention that somebody had been here in the dog. Not seeing him, but I guess he's seen him this weekend. I went up and the dog was on the property. We all had the meeting and we had the dog so he couldn't be out of town, that he had to be out of town. We didn't do it as a dangerous, we did it because of the ownership challenges of Mr. Lally, not doing what we were supposed to, not keeping the dog safe, not letting the dog out running down the street causing mayhem to all the neighbors and other dogs, you know, other dogs in the area. I have the dog at my shelter right now, but I've been speaking with Mr. Lally's son, Scott, who would like to come in front of the board to ask if you guys would release it to his custody for express purpose of being transported into care custody of Lasso Canine Rescue or a no-kill adoption center. Rather than have him put down. And that way there, he will be signed off to the shelter or to a reliable or responsible person that will have to sign that the dog will never be back here in Pembroke again.
Where is this last told?
It's Canton, isn't it?
It's in that. There's two that I'm working with. One's in Canton.
Yes.
One is up.
That's you.
Yes, I am.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And you're saying that you're going to transport that dog?
Yes, I would. I don't. The dog is a good dog. He was my son's dog. My father's done a horrible job taking. He hasn't done what he's supposed to do with the dog. I don't want to see anything happen to the dog. However, I also don't want to see him get adopted to someone that can't handle the dog and have something happen to another dog. So I'm working with some people, saw a couple of different rescues right now, and some prospective foster homes all outside of town that are willing to either foster him and find him a forever home where They have a license to handle pit bulls, and I had asked Bill if, you know, I'll pick up the kennel costs for keeping him there for, you know, for, I'm hoping by the end of this week I can have a place for him. If not, maybe go into next week, and I'll handle all the kennel costs. I don't want him at my property because I have a pit bull and they don't get along.
Yeah, they have had an altercation before.
Yeah, so I just he's a good dog. He's just got someone that's not doing the right thing with him. So I just want to try to hold him with someone that knows about pit bulls and get him out of town so he can't cause any more trouble, and then you guys can deal with my father, deal with whatever you have to. My concern is April.
Yeah, so I think that maybe some of you pick up a letter from whoever you talk to, whether it's Last Hope Canine Rescue or any other place.
Yep.
If we're
released,
we have a copy of a letter from that
organization or the family that's going to take it.
Or if it's a foster family, they're just a letter simply saying that they release you from liability and they'll never be in Pembroke and such and such.
I have a question for Bill. So when we have a dangerous dog hearing, you know, we can't transfer a dog to another town unless the town accepts him.
That's it. If we try it as dangerous. This one wasn't tried. He wasn't. We didn't do him as a dangerous dog. We did him as a nuisance because of lack of owner cooperation with us.
Right. So we don't have that restriction.
They don't have that. We made him get rid of the dog because he couldn't keep the dog safe. Couldn't keep the dog off the street and keep it from causing mayhem. Right. And I've had the dog, I picked him up Saturday, and he's not a real bad dog. His biggest problem is his dog aggression towards other dogs. And that's what his biggest...
He bites somebody.
Well, he bit someone in the process of being biting another dog.
Yeah. Well,
so, I know, but I'm just saying.
Yeah. But I don't have a problem with him delivering him.
Yeah.
The only problem I have is we've already made a motion and agreed to it and all that, things be done.
I would like to see if he could find some place for him and he can get the letter signed by the people. If that was acceptable, that'd be great. I just don't want to see a dog put down for his father's lack of.
And what Bill's saying is we understand that he's a pit bull, his age, and he's got stuff working against him. He was our late son's dog. We're trying to save him. However, if it comes to a point that we can't in a couple of a week or a week and a half can't find a home for him, and the only solution is that he has to be put down. We just asked that we'd be allowed to not do it at the shelter, do it somewhere where he's relaxed and
take him back to their house and they could have the vet come to the house.
Could have the vet come to the house and do it, so
I don't mind doing that.
Well,
it's absolutely, I'm willing to do whatever has to be done. And then the issue with my father is that's between you and him. I'm here for my son's dog.
Yep.
And that's.
Well, the issue that we had with your father was it was taken care of when I took the dog. Was that that if the dog was here, it would be back with us.
Right.
And then we'd make the decisions of what we're going to do.
Right. I put 950 feet of fence up in a day.
Yeah.
And it's like, it just didn't, to leave the gate open is a little bit crazy.
Yeah, I would make a motion that we allow Mr. Wiley here to take his dog son upon a certification of a either Last Hope Canine Rescue or another suitable place that's outside of Pembroke.
Yes, outside of Pembroke.
And that he works with the dog officer in order to bring that forward.
Mm-hmm.
Second.
Motion by Bill, second.
Discussion.
Yes.
Are you going to name a time certain, like by the 17th of the month or something like that?
is not a home for the dog, we'll have to.
How long do you think it may take?
We figured we'd give him 2 weeks.
Yeah, I'm getting text messages now that I have a lady that just lost her dog and is looking to adopt. So I have like 3 people working on different rescue shelters and different foster homes for him. So I said the bill was I hope before the end of the week I can find a home for him. Ultimately I want to find a home instead of sending him to a shelter, but hopefully by the end of the week I'll have something. I might need it until the end of next week, and then we can make a decision if it's. I mean,
he can cover the board for the dog for the 2 weeks if he's there.
The dog is out of public anyway because it's being known, so I don't have a problem with a couple of weeks.
Right, and I'll, like I said, I'll pay for whatever. I'll get his food. I'll pay the board. It's not an issue. And I'm not trying to prolong the thing forever. He's got a lot of work, I guess, but his age, he's a pit bull, he's got dog aggression. I understand that. If it comes to it that we have to put him down, we have to put him down.
Yeah, we just have a job as a selectman, board of selectmen in the town, that we just have to look out for the safety of the public.
Now, I explained to Bill, I know exactly what I've seen him run out, and I've said to my father, if the dog charged me like that, and I didn't know him, the dog would be hurt. I know exactly what he does, and it's the persona of a pit bull, but I still, as a pit bull owner, if I see a pit bull running full tilt out of a garage at me in the street, it's going to make me nervous too. So I'm not trying to defend anything. I totally understand why he was taken. I'm just asking for the opportunity to try to find him a home and do the right thing first.
So they want to set a firm date of 2 weeks, be the 20th?
Second
by Dan. Any other questions or comments? All those in favor of that motion, you say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none.
Thank you, gentlemen.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
See you tomorrow.
You can't see a lot.
Mr. Thorne.
One quick item on my report. We have submitted an application to the Department of Public Utilities for net metering and a number from BPU to go ahead with to continue with our solar project. Just in case we need to have documentation that I'm authorized to sign an application, I would like the board for a vote to authorize the town administrator to sign the application for net metering in the Department of Public Utilities.
So moved. Who would like to get seconded by that? All those in favor? Say aye. Aye. Opposed?
Thank you.
Hearing none.
I want to mention to the board a report from the department head meeting that we had on Friday, in which the town accountant and myself explained the budget situation to the various department heads, and including superintendent, who happens to be in the audience with us tonight. We explained some of the problems that we had with our revenues, that we pretty much have exhausted all revenues and avenues to revenues. We've been looking at the possibility of leasing some town-owned property for commercial ventures. The revenue committee will be given the board a report on that. But basically, I told the department heads that we pretty much maximized all local receipts. We basically budgeted what we collected last year. We hardly ever do that. We try to lowball it so that we'll have more in free cash at the end of the fiscal year. But this particular year, we're really being hit with some fixed costs that we share with the school department. basically, it's the health insurance. We right now are not sure what our bill is going to be with Mayflower for FY18. As I mentioned to the department heads, the treasurer collector and the county accountant myself attended a meeting on the Mayflower steering group in which the discussion centered around having rates adjusted for each plan, and that range from 7% increase for the GIC lookalike, which is the state plan that Mayflower offers, 11% increase that we have in our rate saver plans that we started about 4 years ago, 26% increase for those communities that still offer the old legacy plan, which we had up until 4 years ago. And then a discussion ensued about what a blended rate would be, in which it would be one set rate for all members of Mayflower. Now remember that four towns in a water district are leaving Mayflower effective June 30th. And that would be Hingham, Scituate, Abington, and Rockland, along with the Abington-Rockland Water District. So a third of the membership of Mayflower is leaving in July. And so right now we're hoping that the consultant for Mayflower comes up with a new rate structure at their next meeting, which will be next Wednesday, February 15th. We believe that the steering committee will make a recommendation to the full board. Now, that being said, Mr. Buckley and I are budgeting approximately a 21% increase in health insurance based on the 19% blended rate that we're faced with right now. I know some communities are just sticking with the 11 and daring Mayflower to come up with a 19% increase. We don't think that's very prudent for us. That 21% increase, which includes, we have 24 people that have joined our health insurance program this year, both school and town personnel. That's 24 people. You know, we have a total enrollment of 660. So that was an additional cost to the town. Yes, all new employees pay 25%. Yes, all the unions have pretty much agreed to 25%. But the fact is that 20%, 21% health insurance increase to that line item is $1.5 million. And that is the big ticket right now. So anyway, so Mr. Buckley and I are looking at a proposed budget that we will present, that I will present to the board and to the advisory next Monday. And with that kind of consideration in mind, with the $1.5 million increase in health insurance. And you know, that's basically where we are right now. I hope to present a balanced budget to the board and advisory, you know, with narrative, and you know, and I will tell the board what we had to leave out because of the situation that we have with these fixed costs, such as Plymouth County pension, health insurance, and the debt that the town has incurred over the last 7 years.
So this budget is level funding all the departments and using all forms of cash that we always use, but this time we're using all of it.
Including depleting $600,000 worth of free cash. And to be honest, the only thing that we have not looked at or touched yet that's still available is stabilization. And for the board's information, is $1.3 million in stabilization. Yeah, we've done that before in the past, and it's not up. So, but Mike and I will be working on it, and by next Monday we'll have something that
we will work from. And the board, in addition with the school committee, we'll have to have a meeting, a joint meeting, and talk about some of the things that Mr. Buckley and I have had to leave off the table for the time being.
So, Ed, is there any reason we should discuss the maple hour program, why they're raising the rates so much, or is it, what's the real task, and how do we balance the budgets with what we have, what we anticipate paying?
Well, two different things. I think that what we're doing is we're exploring our options from a health insurance standpoint. We can go it alone. We could, invoke 21, 22, and 23 that the board did 4 years ago and mandate another change in health insurance. That's not the preferred way to do it, but it is an option. We can look at joining what is known as a joint purchase agreement with a couple of towns. Situate is joining MIA, which is the MMA insurance program. Hingham is joining the GIC. They're going in the state program. And Abington and Rockland right now are looking at options. But they have all given notice to Mayflower that they're gone.
Now, is the fact that the membership in Mayflower will be reduced, is that another problem? With less membership, or depends on what their expense ratio is.
Yeah, it depends on what their claims history was. If it was good or bad, or if it's a wash where some were bad and some were good. That question was raised at the steering committee, and the consultant didn't have an answer for that at that time. We're hoping that he does next Wednesday when we have the next meeting.
Now, Ed has already looked at MIA a while ago when we first got wind of these price increases. And with our claims history, which is not terrible, but it isn't exceptionally good either, they gave us a pretty hefty rate, 18%.
Yeah, it was 18 at the time.
18 at the time. That was a little while ago.
And the issue that we would have with that is that MIA only offers Blue Cross Blue Shield, but about 40% of our enrollees, active and retirees, are in Harvard Pilgrim. So we would have to look at that very seriously. And I'm planning on having another insurance advisory committee, which is meeting, which is made up of representatives from all town unions, including the school department. They'll let them know where. What the update is from Mayflower.
Is Mayflower being run correctly? Is that something we can comment on?
Well, I think that one of the things that we have is what we call governance, where you have 37 units. Well, it'll be now 32. And everybody's got one vote. And we are the fourth largest entity in that. And I have one vote. And the New Bedford Board, Wareham Fire District, which has three employees, has one vote. So we've always had a problem with that. And these smaller entities that have the expensive plans but aren't really paying out a whole lot because they only have between 5 to 10 employees, and then you have a Hingham with 1,200, or a Marshville with 1,100, or a Situate with 800, and Pembroke number 4 at 660, have one vote. So even though we, had the 50% of total enrollment, only eight towns had 8 votes out of 37. So that was the issue.
Who runs MIA?
The MMA.
The MMA?
Yeah.
Is that being run well?
Yeah, and actually your rates are based on your experience. Whereas in Mayflower, it's all combined into one pot, so that if, not say that Kingston has a bed ratio or Halifax or Hanover or Marshfield, but if they have worse experience than Pembroke, we're paying for that. You know, and those towns are living off of bad claims experience, but they're only paying, you know, their weighted share. So they're not paying for their claims. So, but, you know, I'll keep the board and the school committee, you know, abreast of, you know, what we're doing about how we're, you know, looking at alternatives, because it's an $8 million line item. And it's not getting any lower. So
why is it going up so much?
Because some towns chose to stay with a real expensive plan that has no deductibles, no outpatient deductibles, less copays for prescription drugs and for specialized physicians. For instance, under the legacy plan that we had 4 years ago, you wouldn't get charged anything for an MRI, and now it costs you $100. So when you have deductibles and higher copays, you have the premiums are less. And people in some communities, some of our neighboring communities, chose not to go and do what the Board of Selectmen did 4 years ago and adopt the Health Insurance Reform Act. They chose not to do it. And so they're in these expensive plans that really benefit their employees, and they take advantage. Yeah, and they take advantage of these great plans by going to the hospital or the emergency room maybe more than they should.
So how are these different plans from each town not weighted at different things?
We tried that, but we got outvoted by the people that have them. It would take 2/3 of a vote of the total membership to make any changes, whether it was governance, you know, weighted vote, or changing plans. We tried to get rid of the expensive plans in December, and the 10 communities that make up the bulk of the membership were voted down.
Do you need any action from this board to notify Mayflower that we're considering alternatives?
Well, they know, because we have to ask Mayflower for claims history. And they know we're not doing it just wallpaper, Beth. You know, they know that we are certainly looking at alternatives. But we need our claims history to show carriers, you know, what Pembroke is made up of.
What's the problem with the GIC plan?
Other than it's got very high deductibles, there's a limit as to the kinds of hospitals that people can use. I know that we looked at that 4 years ago, and basically the teachers union kind of put the stop to that. They were not interested in the GIC. And when you have a public employees committee that has to be formed as part of the Health Insurance Reform Act, there's weighted vote with the unions. And the teachers make up 53% of the total enrollment. But it's something that, you know, we certainly can look at. I mean, we're looking at all options, because it's, you know, it this, you know, and hopefully we might luck out and only get hit with an 11% increase, which would save the town $500,000. That may happen. But right now, you know, we are obligated to budget that 93% blended rate.
So Ed, know what Maya is offering, 18% bump in what we're paying now. We suspect it's between 11 and 21% for Mayflower. What is the cost for the year and a half?
Well, that...
Just so you know, we went there 4 years ago. The public unions did not want to go in GIS. They made that very clear to us. And we understood that. So we negotiated fairly with them when we changed the health laws. So that may have changed in the past 4 years. But I would like to know what the number was, mm-hmm. or would be, okay. Should we join that.
Right.
Okay. We're looking at that as well.
The other issue there, as I remember, I'm not sure if it was going to the GIC or not, but it was the doctors that people had under an existing plan. Would they have the same doctors if we changed the plan? And I don't remember if they would have the Pilgrim.
We didn't pursue it because we knew where the unions were coming from. So that, but I know that in the conversation that we have a health insurance committee that's made up of our treasurer, collectors, and town accountant was the representative of Clerk and Company, who's a firm out of Marshall that specializes in health insurance administration. In fact, they administer Duxbury is self-insured, so they administer Duxbury's health plan. And in addition to plans all over the eastern part of Massachusetts, so we met with their president on Friday, and she had asked us for information that the assistant treasurer is compiling for her. So we're looking at it. We're being very active and looking at it. I mean, we're in Mayflower for one more year at least, so you can't get out of it. It's pretty ironclad. But by December of 2017, we will have to make a decision whether we're staying or leaving.
Okay, we have the superintendent with us this evening.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Would you like to address the board?
No, I'm just here to hear what Ed has to say. The board will start their discussions tomorrow night. I think the piece that drives home the most for us and what Ed said was that the level funded budgets don't fund our collective bargaining agreements. Similar other departments in the town, it's a supplemental appropriation at town meeting. The school committee funds it within the operating budget. So if the budget is level funded, it doesn't allow us to fund the agreements we've already made with our collective bargaining units. So that's our biggest concern right now.
Okay. Any other point you'd like to make?
No, I've shared enough right now.
Now, next Monday night, you won't have any new information about the insurance because they're meeting a week from this Wednesday.
That's correct.
There may be some news, but it won't be.
Yeah, we're budgeting in the worst case scenario right now.
Okay. Any other questions about the budget or Ed?
No, I just think, and Dan, I think was going there. Do we put Mayflower on notice now, even though it's probably a half a year to do so, to let them know that we're looking very seriously going in another direction, and maybe that direction is Rockland and Abington. Mm-hmm. If they seem to think they can stand alone, it must be a pretty good plan structure.
Well, I can't speak for those two communities and why they did that. So,
any other questions for Ed? Then we'll go on to ask the selectmen. Any issues under Ask the Select from anybody? Hearing none, we'll move to new business. Anyone have any new business? Hearing none, upcoming issues that we have scheduled next week, the 13th at 7 p.m., Jennifer Mathias, the Hill Bog Project update. We haven't heard from Mathias family for 3 or 4 years, so we need an update on that. Also at the 13th, we have a poll hearing.
a joint petition, National Grid and Verizon, Elm Street pole number 21-84. And again on the 13th, the board will vote to open the annual town meeting warrant, and it will close on March 3rd. On February 27th, Gail Sim, First Church in Pembroke, a request for the use of the town memorial green. Also on the 27th, Planning Board public hearings, proposed zoning bylaw amendment. Does anyone have any other statement or issue that they'd like to bring up at this time?
Yeah, the question is, check the comments on what business is going to come before the selectmen and talk about their business.
Well, we had Dave Shea came in, and I understand that he brought up his visit here at the chamber meeting and asked if any members would like to get on a list where they could notify us and come before us and tell us what they're doing. And I haven't heard that we have got anybody yet. But
is there a possibility to put the Road Police Boys Club on that list? That we could bring the instructors from the Boys Club over and introduce themselves and talk about the Boys Club and what's going on over there and what's happened and what we're doing.
Yeah, I have no objection. Any comments from the board?
Business of sorts. If you could give us a date in the future, then we could plan to possibly put some type of a demonstration on toy if we had the other part of the room here. We bring in boxing instructors and all that. The program is going really well, and I think that those instructors should be applauded by the board for the number of years that they've donated their time and efforts over there. That because none of them are being paid, it's a volunteer thing for the instructors. So that would be. We kind of let the townspeople know a little bit about what's going on over there. Also, we would like to have an open house and open up the facility. Some of the people who have been here for 40 years have never been inside and don't know what's going on over there. So just to show the availability of what we have and what we do there. We'll be instructed of that. So if we can have a date in the future, we can talk about that. You know, maybe sometime in March.
I consensus here that sounds like a good idea. I'd certainly be in favor of doing that. You could work with Sabrina on a date.
Sure.
And we'll move forward on that suggestion. Good idea.
Good, thank you.
Do we have a need for executive session, Mr. Paul?
Not at this time, Mr. Chairman.
Does anyone have any other issues to bring before the board?
The only thing I can say is that there is no ice on the pond. So we don't have to worry. I've seen the swans and stuff. They're all started coming out of some of February. But no, it makes me happy not to see any ice out there. So the kids aren't out there, or dogs or animals, or whatever. It's great. So
very good. So have a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Is there a motion by Bill? Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Matthew. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. That concludes the Board of Selectmen's meeting for tonight. We will be back on the 13th at 7 p.m.
I'll send you some.